Thank you.
And I think we can move
Bye-bye.
on to our third presentation for the afternoon, actually the third and final presentation. Monica Valluri from Astronomy. Let me see here. So we see you, Monica. I guess we need to see your slides. So while she's putting it up, the title of the project is Probing the Nature of Dark Matter by Modeling the Milky Way. And so Monica's project is also one of the most recent, part of the most recent cohort of MICD Catalyst grants. And there are a number of co-PIs. And yes, however, I'll leave that to Monica to talk about. Yep, I see them all up there. Okay,
Can you see
Monica,
the
as
slide?
with the others, I'll give you a heads up at about 20 minutes into your talk. Just as a heads up
Okay.
for.
Okay, so thank you for inviting me to give this talk. It's a pleasure to be able to describe some of the work that's been going on in my group on trying to probe the nature of dark matter by modeling the Milky Way. There's a fairly large number of collaborators on this project, and I will mention the ones who are most actively involved as we go along. So to just give you some sense of context, with every galaxy, including the Milky Way, is embedded in a dark matter halo. And we think that that dark matter halo comprises between 80 and 90% of the total gravitating mass in the galaxy. Its presence is inferred purely from its gravitational influence on visible matter, like stars and hydrogen gas. And to date, despite several decades, couple of decades of particle physics experiments trying to detect the dark matter, the dark matter particle has so far not been discovered. And so astrophysical constraints on dark matter are considered likely to be extremely useful for identifying the nature of the dark matter particle, in particular, whether it's relativistic or not, and what kind of interactions dark matter particles might have amongst themselves. Some of the things that we do know about dark matter comes from cosmological simulations. And these simulations predict some very specific things. First, they predict that the dark matter halo of galaxies like the Milky Way should be not spherical, but triaxial. That is, they have three unequal symmetry axes. At small radii, they are likely to be flattened, but they become more triaxial at large radii. Other predictions include that the density profile at the center should be fairly cuspy. That is, its density is rising steeply. In a power law sense at the center, and that there are a large number of small satellites, that little things that you can see, fuzzy balls that you can see around the galaxy, many of which might have been disrupted by tidal field from the Milky Way. So our goal in this project is to test some of these predictions by modeling stars in the Milky Way halo. In particular, we don't know whether the Milky Way's disk is how it is oriented relative to the dark matter halo. It could be aligned with its with the rotation axis parallel to the short axis, or it could be aligned in the other direction. The data that we're going to use for this modeling comes from a map which was made by a satellite called Gaia, and this map is presented here. It's not a photograph, it's actually a map which consists of a billion individual stars whose brightness and position have been accurately obtained and then plotted on this map. That at the center shows the center of our galaxy. There are a couple of satellites, the large and small Magellanic clouds. The dark areas show dust in the galaxy. And as I said, this map was obtained by the Gaia satellite, which is a European Space Agency satellite, which was launched in 2013. The first data release was obtained in September of 2016. The second data release, which was obtained in 2018, is the one that we'll be using the data from, and future data releases are expected into the next in the coming years. So the satellite obtains what is called parallax, that is, it obtains the geometric distances to stars and proper motions, that is, their motion across the plane of the sky, and it does this for a billion stars. It also obtains the Doppler velocities for about 100,000 stars, the brightest of these billion stars. There are also ground-based spectroscopic surveys which give additional Doppler velocities. So our goal is to model something like several million of these stars which lie within about 30 or 40 kiloparsecs from the center. A kiloparsec, a parsec being about 10 to the 16 meters. So the way we're going to do this is by what's called distribution function fitting, where we assume that the function, the distribution function, which describes the stars, that is, it gives you the density of stars per unit volume, per unit physical volume, per unit velocity, volume in velocity space. That is an unknown quantity. And we also don't know what the dark matter distribution is. That's the second unknown quantity. And of course, we know what the normal matter is, where it, that is distributed. That's what we call the baryonic distribution. We see that in, from observations. So the dark matter and the baryons together constitute the gravitational potential. And it is in this potential that the stars are orbiting, and so the distribution function that we compute has to be self-consistent with this gravitational potential. So we use a variety of different data from Gaia. That is, in some cases we have six-dimensional data, but for the most part, because for majority of the stars there are only proper motions, we don't have radial velocities. We'll only get five-dimensional data. And then we construct a Bayesian model to infer the properties of the model, that is, the properties of the distribution function, the properties of the dark matter halo, by matching individual properties of individual stars, taking account of the fact that there is a certain selection function, you don't see everything, and the errors on the data. So to just give you a sense of what action modeling is, orbits and galactic potentials admit three isolating integrals of motion. And a well-known theorem called the Jeans theorem argues that the phase-based distribution functions of stars and galaxies should be a function of these integrals of motion. So in practice, you can use any integrals, but these actions are particularly useful. And therefore, it is actually very important to be able to evaluate actions from the phase-space coordinates. And the action is defined as by this equation 1, and where P is the canonically conjugate momentum for each of the coordinates. And so in this graph, for instance, you see a typical rosette orbit, which you would see in a spherical potential, and it is it has some of the actions that it conserves are the angular momentum, energy, and a third action which in this case is the total angular momentum. So there have been lots of classical methods for evaluating actions. These are well known from classical mechanics. In flattened systems, it is possible to make something called the epicyclic approximation and then calculate the actions in that manner. Until recently, it has not been possible to compute actions for general potentials similar to those that we see in galaxies. In 2012, Professor James Binney from University of Oxford came up with what is called the Stackel fudge, where he argued that since the most general form of a potential that can for which you can compute actions is a separable Stackel potential, which which is given by this expression phi in a coordinate system which is a confocal ellipsoidal coordinate system, you can calculate the motions in two directions, lambda and nu, with their canonically conjugate momenta, P lambda and P nu, by two separate equations. And that the actions are then, J lambda and J mu are easily computed using integrals over, which can be computed by numerical quadrature. So Binney showed that this Stackel fudge, even though most galaxies do not have Stackel potentials, if you pick a Stackel potential which is approximately equal to a Stackel potential, you can get accurate actions to within 1% for most disk orbits. So the red points in this graph show a previous kind of approximation called the adiabatic approximation, whereas the Stackel fudge shows the black triangles show the Stackel fudge. And what we want to see is that this is computed as an orbit evolves over several hundred dynamical times. And since actions are meant to be conserved, you see that the Stackel fudge gives you almost constant values varying by about 1%, whereas the previous approximations gave much wider, much greater variation. So although this Binney's method works well, it's not extremely efficient for general potentials. And so my collaborator, Eugene Vasiliev, who's a postdoc currently at Cambridge, developed a flexible code called a flexible package called Agama, which computes actions in general potentials for much thicker orbits. So this is just a two-dimensional projection of an orbit, and it's a 10 times faster than the Stackel fudge. It does fail in some places, but it has been remarkably powerful. And Agama, the power of Agama and the fact that it's been so powerful is illustrated in the fact that this package has been used in over 40 publications in the last year and a half. So some of the limitations of Agama as it stands now are is that it still only works for axisymmetric potentials, and it is not so it doesn't work for the kind of triaxial potentials we think that exist in galaxies. And the speed of the computation of the potential is extremely critical to having fast action computation. So one of the goals of this project was to try and convert the action finder to such that it could run on a GPU. And Alexander Genko from CSCAR, so the MICDE grant allowed us to hire Dr. Genko, who's an expert in GPU programming and other things like, and other computational aspects, to help us with transforming this Agama code such that it could work on actions. And these plots give you basically an analysis of the performance. So the code, of course, improves with multiple threads. This is for tests with about 2,000 stars, and it runs the time per star is quadratic per star because of various because of the accuracy requirements. So one of the things that that has been done so far is that Alexander Genko has identified the parts of the Agama code which are performance bottlenecks, and in particular, there are axisymmetric action integrators. And so he has been testing, and he's been showing that the two things which take up a significant portion of the time are can be adapted. And he's done some tests with proxy codes for these root finders, which are used in the action finders, and finds a 7 times speed up is possible. And so we think that over a fairly short time scale, by the end of certainly by the end of this year, we should be able to have a version of Agama which works on GPU, and will allow us to do the kinds of analysis we need with stars with the sample sizes we have. So by the Agama is a C++ code, but it is there's a Python interface, and so the code that we are actually using for the modeling of the galaxy is called iGalapagos, and it's a Python code. And so some of the results that we have from that so far are a modeling of the Milky Way halo of a sample of stars called RR Lyrae stars, which come from the Gaia satellite. And this analysis, this is just a distribution in what are called galactic coordinates, L being the what we call longitude and B being latitude, galactic longitude and galactic latitude at the center of the galaxy is at 0, 0. And this analysis has been running, has been done by Kohei Hattori on a high performance computing network. Kohei was here as a postdoc, but has recently moved to Carnegie Mellon, where he's running this code on 320 cores, where it takes a week of wall time. Right now, we are only running with 4,000 stars, but we have 16,700 RR Lyrae stars. And then in the future data releases will give us up to 100,000 stars. So the analysis that he has done so far includes some validation tests, which show that you can fit the rotation curve, that's the circular velocity curve of the Milky Way, to get the dark matter and the model for the baryons, and also the acceleration of the stars above and below the disk. And most impressively, in these two panels on the right, the one panel shows the data for the RR Lyrae stars, the panel on the extreme right shows the model. And some of the things you can see are there's a quadrupolar symmetry here, which our model picks up. There's a certain, and this is showing the correlation between two proper motion components. This is showing the dispersion in the proper motion in the latitude direction. And so the distribution, these plots on the right tell us that the distribution function that of the actual stars is being well recovered, and the shape of the dark matter halo, the rotation, other data are being well fitted. And this modeling tells us that the rotational, that the halo shape within 20 kiloparsec is almost spherical, it's almost nearly spherical. And this is encouraging, but one of the things that I said before was that this is not based on a triaxial model yet, because the goal has been to improve our modeling so that we can get to the triaxial models. Another test that we're doing is being done by Pablo Fernandez de Salas, who's a postdoc in Stockholm working with me and Katie Fries. And he's applying the same code iGalapagos to a set of simulations, cosmological simulations called the LATE simulations from Andrew Wetzel, who was a speaker in one of the MICD colloquia this past year. These simulations have satellites, have experienced mergers, and are very representative of the Milky Way. And one of the simulations that, one of the assumptions we make in our modeling is that the Milky Way is in equilibrium, which it is not. And so one of the tests that we are doing is to see how badly our models work if we make the assumption of dynamical equilibrium. This is the model for the LATE galaxy. This is the shows its flattening. It's quite a flattened halo, unlike the real Milky Way, and has an axis ratio within 20 kiloparsec of about 0.6. So it's quite flat, like a pancake. So our goal is to test how the measurement of the shape is affected by disequilibrium. So our preliminary tests have been done by generating a whole sample of mock halo stars from the cosmological simulation, from the LATE simulation. We have three different simulations, and we are making mock data in three different positions in the galaxy because we don't know, because the sun is in some arbitrary position, and our ability to observe the galaxy only gives us a limited view of the stars in the galaxy. And iGalapagos has been run on these mock data. And so far, we get, so if the red curves here show the potential, the true potential, and the blue curve shows the best fit potential from stars, dark matter, and gas. And the shape that is obtained here is 0.7. And I said that the true data, true, and the data used currently are only within 25 kiloparsec. I said that the true shape is actually something like 0.66. So this is not bad. It's definitely in better than 10%. But if we are going to do more tests to understand how sensitive this is to various, you know, to the kinds of non-equilibrium effects from satellites. As I said earlier, the Milky Way is not in equilibrium, and in fact, there are many satellites which are currently being tidally disrupted by the galaxy. One of which is the Sagittarius stream, and Sagittarius is shown in this image here. A graduate student who's working with us, Yu Jia Wu from the physics department, has been looking at using actions of these stars of in the halo to try and find merger events which you don't see any longer in terms of these streams. So the idea is that in an adiabatically varying gravitational potential, the actions of trajectories are approximately conserved. So even if the tidal disruption of a satellite by the potential spreads the debris across the entire sky, making it hard to detect, if you find if you have six-dimensional phase space data, that is three positions and three velocities, and a knowledge of the potential, which we will obtain from, say, iGalapagos, you can then hunt for previously accreted satellites using clustering in action space. And so the questions that we hope to answer with this are, since the potential is not really adiabatically invariant, I mean, it is somewhat adiabatically invariant, but not exactly. How massive does a satellite need to be detectable? And how recently should it have been accreted to still be detectable in action space? So, and the other question, which is relevant to our understanding of dark matter, is that some of this debris, not necessarily all of it, but some of this debris is likely to be near to the position of the sun. And so if we can tell that there are correlations between dark matter debris and stellar debris from satellites, we might be able to use this to detect over densities in dark matter, which could be helpful for direct detection experiments. So the work that has been done by Yuja is in collaboration with Robin Sanderson and Andrew Wetzel at UC Davis. And they gave us the, you know, data on the infalling satellites to some of these galaxies that's plotted here in action space. So each color represents one of these 16 different satellites which came into this galaxy whose actions are at the present time are computed in the potential and plotted in action space. So without actually knowing this information about the actual satellites, Yuja applied a clustering algorithm to the actions using two different kinds of clustering algorithms. One was called StarGo, which uses a self-organizing map, and the other is something called N-Link, which is a density-based clustering. Hello? In multidimensional space. This plot shows the clusters in action spaces identified by this software called N-Link. And this is, there is a good amount of correspondence between these two. We use a couple of different metrics. One is called purity and one is called recovery, which tells us what fraction of a particular object which fell in is recovered by one of the clusters in action space. And how much contamination, so that's what's called recovery. And the second quantity, purity, tells us how much contamination there is from other satellites. And so this shows the total mass of all of the satellites that fell in versus the time at which they fell in. And the shapes tell us whether the purity and the recovery match each other. So if the purity and recovery are both high, then they're represented by a triangle. But if one is, you know, purity is high but the recovery is not, it's represented by a circle. So we see that only satellites with masses of above a billion solar masses, which fell in less than 7 giga years ago, 7.5 giga years ago, about half the age of the universe. So the top left-hand corner gives us gives us an understanding of what satellites we can currently recover in a simulation like LATE. So I don't know how much time I have left.
You are at about 25 minutes.
Okay. So in that case, I think I'm going to stop. There's another project that we're doing, which has to do with identifying streams in the halo, also using actions, but I will skip that because it was not part of our original project description. So I want to just conclude by saying that we have adopted this multi-pronged computational effort to try and constrain the properties of dark matter using observations of the Milky Way stellar halo. One of the things we've done so far has to apply our action-based distribution function fitting code to our LIRE data, which have told us, you know, which have been useful for measuring the shape of the halo. We are testing assumptions of dynamical equilibrium. We are also using this action computation to identify previously accreted satellites to understand the accretion history of the halo and detect maybe local dark matter. And we're also doing a bunch of N-body simulations, which I didn't describe, to try and constrain the properties of the central density profiles of dark matter halos. Successes are that, you know, I want to thank MICDE for this funding, which has enabled a lot of this research, especially the GPU acceleration that is being done by Alex Genko and the work that is being done by Yuja Wu. And I also want to say that the process of the robust process of proposal evaluation and feedback, the extremely helpful feedback from the MICDE grant cycle enabled us to get a NASA grant. We applied for it in July, and we were notified that it was awarded in November. So this research will continue to be funded by NASA. So I'll stop there and take questions.
Great. Thanks, Monica. Also, thanks for bringing up that little mention of the extra success that this sort of program promotes. As before, attendees, please post your questions in the chat box. We'll pick them up. Maybe I can start out with, I do have a couple of questions. And the first is related to just trying to get an outsider's understanding of the halo. So when you say that the halo appears differently at smaller radii, how does one understand that? Because if one just looks at it as a three-dimensional ellipsoid sitting around the galaxy, what is the difference? Is it the density distribution that appears different at smaller radii? So if you just look at the high density near the small at that smaller radii, that region of higher density is flattened out? Or
yes. If you measure the shape, if you take the shape of the density, so if you look at the moment of inertia tensor, for instance, mm-hmm. if you take the mass as a function of radius, you calculate the moment of inertia tensor, you'll find that at small radii, the eigenvectors will be orthogonal, and of course their eigenvalues of the three components at the moment of inertia tensor will be equal, approximately equal, or at least two of them will be equal, one of them will be flatter. But as you go out, the, you know, those eigenvalues of the moment of inertia tensor as you go out in radius will become more and more different. And so that's why we call it triaxial at large radii, but, you know, sort of axis symmetric, or nearly, at least we've seemed to find that it's almost spherical at small radii.
So okay, and the, this is, I guess, the very naively, this is some sort of a mass effect that the main body of the galaxy is pulling in the dark matter as well. But the dark matter is much denser. I mean, there's much more of the dark matter, right? So why should it? Yeah, okay.
So at small radii, you know, within the solar radius, but also within the Milky Way the disk. A region of the galaxy, which is sort of very sort of less than inner one third of the dark matter halo, the mass of the gravity of the Milky Way stars and gas dominates. So you would think that the potential should be much flatter, but the process by which the halo has been built up has led to, you know, repeated episodes of feedback from star formation and other things, which have sort of puffed up the entire potential and made it significantly rounder. I would say that most of the simulations don't predict a spherical halo at small radii. They predict a quite flattened halo, but it seems like our calculations are showing that it is probably close to spherical. And this method is not the only one that has found this. I mean, the same kind of data we applied, using a different method called the genes equations method, found essentially the same result. So we think that it's a robust result, and we'll have to understand better. I mean, it could be telling us about something about the nature of dark matter. So there are certain types of dark matter models, some of which are called specifically self-interacting dark matter, does tend to dissipate more. I mean, the particles interact at small in regions of high density, causing the potential to become more spherical at small radii. So I think it's too early to say that it's one versus the other, but there are other kinds of dark matter species which explain this kind of round shape.
And so actually that leads to the other question that I also wanted to ask, which is that now with your Bayesian approach, what aspects of the model are you refining, right? So I guess you have some priors for certain parameters in the model.
So there are actually something like 16 parameters in the model. Several parameters which describe the density distribution of the dark matter. So there's a central slope, central density cusp. It's a profile. I mean, sort of it's in log space, it's sort of, you know, r to the power some alpha, where, you know, so that's a free parameter. It sort of turns over in radius at some radius, so that's another free parameter. The absolute density at the center is the third free parameter, the total mass. The flattening is another parameter. Then there are parameters which describe. So although we know something about the overall mass distribution of the baryons, we're not assuming it directly. We're assuming a certain profile, a density profile for the stars, density profile for the gas, and so there are those are the, you know, all of those are free parameters. There are certain ranges over which we are assuming. In most cases, flat priors, or uniform priors. So there are a few systems, a few parameters for which we need to apply slightly different priors. But the distribution function also has some power law form. So there are certain priors on that as well, certain parameters from that as well. But yeah, 16 different parameters go into this modeling.
And how are you doing the sampling? For the Bayesian approach? Yeah, sorry.
It's a Markov.
It is an MC. Okay.
Yeah. It's not, I think it's just, yeah, it's just one of the standard. Maybe there are ways to make it go faster, but it's a sort of it's one something called MCE, MCE, which is quite commonly used in astronomy.
I don't know if Mariana, are you seeing any other questions in the Q&A yet? Or?
No, there's no questions in the Q&A.
Okay. There aren't any other questions and nothing else from the moderators. So thank you, Monica, and thanks to everybody who participated in this second session, Stephen, Shuin, and Monica, and of course all your co-PIs and attendees and everybody. So, as you heard before, this was supposed to be part of the MICD symposium. We intended to do the part that we thought was more critical to MICD's functioning and part of the and has a role in the rest of our programs. The current Catalyst grant process is underway, and we do have other. The symposium itself will occur for now. It is planned for September 29th. The plan is to have it in person, if that is allowed by then. And but before that, next Friday, on the 17th, we have a webinar by Marisa Eisenberg from the School of Public Health. Marisa has been working directly with the state in modeling and advice in modeling the progression of COVID-19 in Michigan. She's been very busy with that, actually. It's taken a while to find for to set it up so that she could pull herself away from all of that very important work and to give us this webinar that is planned for 3 p.m. on April 17th, using most likely the same format. So we hope many of you will be able to attend that. Otherwise, thanks everybody, and we will, I guess, see you all around in various video chats and webinars and so forth. But otherwise, as is common, please stay well and stay safe.